Live from Paradise Studios in New York, Strong Island Television presents Under the Radar, starring Randy Unger.
Brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a two to match your attitude.
Tonight, we're going to be interviewing filmmaker Joe O'Connell of the new documentary, Danger God. Randy will also be reviewing the new films, Official Secrets and Angel Has Fallen, with special guest critics Erica A., Rachel Kolb, and Evan Laws. And now, here's your host, Randy Unger.
Hey guys, this is Under the Radar, where we talk all things film, from big to small, we cover it all. And right now, we have, on Skype right now, we have filmmaker Joe O'Connell of the awesome new documentary, Danger God, which basically talks about the lives and loves of stuntman Gary Kent. He was very popular in the 60s and 70s. There he is right now on the screen. And yeah, we've got Joe on Skype right now. Hey Joe, how's it going?
Hey, good. Thanks for having me.
Sure. This is great. So I watched it last night. I loved it. I love anything behind the scenes of, you know, old school Hollywood, that, you
right.
know, that exploitation period, the drive-in movie era. Tell everyone, how did the idea for this documentary come about?
It was 20 years ago. I went to a writer's conference in Austin, Texas, and I met this guy. He looked kind of like a silver-haired Burt Reynolds, had the silver mustache, white mustache, really. Cool guy. I started talking to him. This is Gary Kent. And I was and still am a film journalist in Austin, Texas. And I went home and told my wife, then my girlfriend, now my wife, I got to talk to this guy. I got to interview him. So I tracked him down. The first thing I did was go rent Satan Sadus, which Gary stars in as the good guy Vietnam vet. It's his one role where he's the good guy. And so I interviewed him and then became friends with him. And kept telling him that someone needed to do a documentary about him. And then his memoir was coming out. And I said, man, I guess it's me. And so I got into action and basically learned how to make a documentary. I'm completing a second one right now, documentary about Robert Burns, the art director on Chainsaw Massacre, and his obsession with Rondo Hatton. And this one, a lot quicker. We're in post-production on it right now.
Okay.
But yeah, Gary's story needed to be told. Yeah. It had to be out there. He's the most interesting man in the world.
Yeah, he really is. He could have definitely done those beer commercials.
Yeah. He'd be a better guy for it. He'd be the real thing.
So do you yourself have a history of stunt acting or acting in general?
I've done little bit parts, but I'm a writer.
Yeah.
A writer of fiction and a writer of journalism, most of it about film.
Okay.
I was a film columnist for the Austin American Statesman, Austin Chronicle, and Dallas Morning News.
Okay.
Until I kind of left that behind me to do my own stuff.
Okay. Now, I'm curious.
What, wanted to create stuff instead of.
Yeah. So this is a fascinating documentary. It sheds a light on a man a lot of people don't really know of. He was more behind the scenes. I know he was the double for Jack Nicholson in a number of films.
Yeah, a lot of Jack Nicholson's early films. Gary kind of lied his way into being a stuntman. He was an athlete. He was a quarterback at the University of Washington, and he grew up in rural areas of Washington State, riding horses, so he knew how to do stuff.
Yeah.
But he talked his way into doing two Monty Hellman films, one of them both starring Jack Nicholson, one of them written by Jack Nicholson, the shooting and riding the whirlwind. He didn't know what he was doing at all. And other stuntmen saw what he was doing. He wasn't doing it safely, really. But then he learned, and he was also Man from U.N.C.L.E., television show. He was Robert Vaughn's stuntman in that.
Oh, okay.
He'd done 100 films. He's been involved in 100 films. And he would do anything just to keep working. That was kind of his motto.
Wow.
You know, the line for actors was long. And he saw the stuntmen doing this stuff. And he said, yeah, I need to do that. I'll get a job. I'll be able to work. you know.
Right. Doing the work nobody else wants to do.
Right. And he was there with the independent film scene when the drive-in movies were coming in. He was involved. He was just right in the middle of that. And sometimes it was stuff like director Ray Dennis Steckler was Gary's neighbor. And so Steckler said, "Hey, Gary, come star in this movie. Come be in The Thrill Killers." Okay. You know, and he ends up being in pretty iconic independent films from that era. Yeah. Just because, you know, he was parking cars at the Fog Cutter, a restaurant in Los Angeles, doing it with Don Jones, who went on to direct Gary and Schoolgirls in Chains and The Forest, a couple of good bad movies. And so it was just kind of he and his buddies helped each other out and kept working and kept doing it. Okay. You know, that was their motto: just keep working, just keep doing it.
Now I'm curious, Joe, what was the research process like for this film?
The first thing I did was go to Gary's house and get all of his videotapes and started going through all that stuff, all of the stuff that he'd made. And then just starting to talk to everybody. Gary has a memoir. And you know, that was a starting place to see what he said, but the movie is not the memoir, is not a recreation of the memoir, but it covers, you know, a lot of the ground that we thought was important. Gary worked a lot with Al Adamson. And was the last person to talk to him before Al Adamson was killed, before he was murdered. Al Adamson had a handyman, and the handyman was ripping him off and hit him over the head and buried him underneath a hot tub at his house.
Jesus.
And then drove off and was in his car using his credit cards and spending his cash until he got caught. And Gary was the last guy to talk to Al. And Al Adamson was pretty fascinating.
Now that sounds like
a very straight guy, straight and narrow guy who made crazy movies.
Yeah.
You know, people have heard about Ed Wood. They should be hearing about Al Adamson.
Okay.
And I got to go to New Jersey and talk to Sam Sherman, who is the brains behind Al Adamson. He's the money guy and the promoter. You know, they would release these movies and they would have like a million different names for the same movie. And to go to Sam Sherman's house was a real treat in New Jersey. His basement is full of film, original prints of stuff. It's just amazing. You know, so that was a lot of fun to do that kind of stuff.
Great, great. Now, do you plan on shedding a spotlight on any other notable figures from Hollywood history?
Well, I'm doing the one on Robert Burns, and he's pretty fascinating. He was the art director on Chainsaw Massacre, The Howling, The Hills Have Eyes, Reanimator, Microwave Massacre, what else? Demonoid. He made these little crawling hands in Demonoid. He was just an amazing guy. And I'm kind of interested in the personal stories of these people as well. You see that with me talking about Gary Kent because I'm...
Yeah. Now, what is it like just being behind the scenes and just working with talent in this capacity? You get to know them on a personal level as well as a professional, correct? Joe, hello. Technical difficulties. Reconnecting. Sorry, guys, a little technical difficulties. But the guys watching at home on your devices, check out Danger God. It's a wonderful documentary about stuntman Gary Kent. And it's a really interesting, there he is again. And it's just a great, great film.
I 40s. So I don't know, I'm looking at maybe a third film. I don't know if I can pull it off yet or not. So I'm still working on that.
Okay, sounds good. And any other projects you're currently working on, Joe?
Well, I'm working on something about the Ross sisters. I don't know if you know who the Ross sisters. If you looked them up, you'd know who they were.
Okay, sounds familiar.
The Ross sisters were three young girls in Texas back in the Depression era, and their mother taught them to be acrobats and contortionists. They became an internet sensation. They were in a movie called Broadway Rhythm in the 40s.
Okay,
and it had an internet revival because it's so crazy. the scene of what they do. They sing and dance, and then all of a sudden they're doing crazy contortion moves. And I've been working on a project, and it may end up being a movie. I don't know, but it's more like a book at this point. And I went to, they ended up in London performing on a stage show there, and they all got married, and there were a lot of tragedies involved. But I wonder what happened to them. So I started researching them. And that's kind of what happens to me. I'm interested in the story, and I start researching it, and I keep going, you know.
That's cool.
I don't know if I'll have another genre documentary or not. I'll have to see what comes up that interests me.
What made you decide to tackle the Ross sisters? Because that sounds very ambitious, actually.
It's very ambitious. I'd have to do it with Rondo and Bob. A lot of what we did is recreations because Robert Burns killed himself.
No.
Died. If we do the Ross sisters, we first off have to find some young women who can do contortion stuff.
Okay.
So I don't know where I'm finding that. And we'd have to recreate their story. It's kind of involved. Huh. And it's tragic for most of them, not for all, but
Is it going to be like a docudrama?
One died with a drug overdose in London.
Are you gonna tell the real story? Like you're gonna show archival footage and like kind of combine that with like actors recreating their
Yeah. There's not that much archival footage of them, so that's the problem.
Mm.
And with Rondo and Bob, I've kind of been doing the same thing. We recreated Rondo Hatton, you know what Rondo Hatton looks like? He had acromegaly. Uh-huh. He's the namesake of the Rondo Awards.
Okay.
Given out for the best in horror. Okay. And Rondo Hatton had an acromegaly, so his face was like grossly distorted.
Okay.
And we had to recreate that. So we had to bring in a mask guy who did that and also aged his widow because Bob Burns was obsessed with Rondo Hatton.
Okay.
And that's kind of the story. And tracked down his widow and met her when she was an older woman.
Hmm.
So we had an actor playing her when she was young, and we aged her for the scene where they met.
Hmm.
And it's amazing. We got a guy who's just fantastic.
Okay.
You know, very lucky. Otherwise, you got to be lucky, it seems like. And you got to stick with it, you know.
Or just have an interest in history. You're very passionate about history. I see that.
yeah.
And
kind of about movies, you know, I'm into movies, and always have been. And I was one of the monster kids. I was watching Friday nights when I was a kid. I was watching out of San Antonio, Texas. They had Project Terror, where the scientific and the terrifying merge. Was their little logo, and so I watched all of the old horror films from that when I was a kid.
Huh.
I don't know if people do as much anymore, but I watched all this 1950s stuff that I think is amazing, and then on into 70s type horror films.
No, you know what? I'm totally with you on the nostalgia factor there, Joe. There's a few theaters in New York City that they kind of recreate the drive-in movie feel, but no,
cool.
Yeah, I mean they serve food during the movie and they show like older films from the 70s and 80s. One theater, the Nighthawk Cinema. I don't know if you frequented that establishment.
No,
it's great. If you're ever in Brooklyn, New York, I would totally check that out.
in Austin, we have the home base of the Alamo Drafthouse.
Yeah. Okay. There you go. Yeah.
And we have, we haven't talked about that as far as Danger God, but Gary appears before every showing of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Quentin Tarantino's movie.
Perfect.
Talking about stunts and talking about Charles Manson.
Mm-hmm.
Gary, you know, Gary is at least part of the inspiration for Brad Pitt's stuntman character in that movie.
And it's great.
And so every Alamo around the country showing Gary, which is very cool.
And it's very, it's great that you guys,
go ahead.
Came out with Danger God kind of in a few weeks after Once Upon a Time in Hollywood came out. So very, very good timing on your part, sir.
Yeah, it's fairly coincidental. You know, there's no big plan behind all this.
Mm-hmm.
It was just time for the movie to come out, and I got a great distributor in Wild Eye Releasing, and they're doing their best to get the word out.
Yeah,
DVD comes out on September 17th. We're already out there streaming,
nice.
And then a Blu-ray from Dark Side Releasing on November 12th.
Okay,
which will have a lot of cool extras with it.
Cool. Now, I'm curious, Joe, what do you hope audiences take away from the film?
You know, the message that Gary says is find something you like to do and keep on doing it till you die.
Yeah.
The audience is something. And I was also just like, I would like people to go and watch older movies and check them out and not expect perfection, but go find the beauty in the imperfection of the movie. You know, because Gary was in they call them B movies in my mind as bad movies. You know, Gary was in movies like Dracula versus Frankenstein, mm-hmm. the Incredible Two-Headed Monster.
Cool. Now, what are some of your all-time
crazy movies?
I'm curious, Joe. What are some of your all-time favorite films?
Of what variety? Yeah.
I mean,
what's that?
I mean, we can go from Gary Kent's filmography or just overall.
Gary Kent did a movie called Targets, and he played a small role in it. He did some special effects and stunts. Mm-hmm. And Targets is an incredible movie that I don't think a lot of people have heard of. It's Peter Bogdanovich, one of his first movies.
Nice.
And in Austin, they had the tower shooting in 1966.
Okay.
Peter Bogdanovich's wife was there at the time when that happened. It was the first big shooting on a campus in the country. It's commonplace now, but it wasn't then. And they did something where it's a character who's very much Charles Whitman, the guy who shot from the tower.
Okay.
Yet in the end, he shoots out of the drive-in movie screen at the audience, which is just an incredible concept, you know, if you think about it. And it's a really well done film. Okay. Boris Karloff's in it, which is really weird.
That is
weird. In his waning days.
Targets? Okay. But, what year was that?
Yeah.
What year was that, Joe?
I'm sorry, I'm losing you.
Sorry, what year was Targets?
What year was that film made? Targets, it's, you know, I guess about 69 or so, something like that. It wasn't too far removed from the tower shooting.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit late, maybe more like 70 or 71.
Okay.
Not sure.
Well, Joe, we're about out of time here. I was curious, how can people see Danger God? It's a great documentary. How can people access this film?
Right. It's out there streaming iTunes, Amazon Prime. If you're a Spectrum subscriber, it's on pay-per-view on there. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of other places, too. Not quite to Netflix yet, but I think will be.
Okay.
Wi-Fi pretty much hits everybody. I'm hoping to have somebody tell me it's in Redbox soon, too, because I still think Redbox is cool.
Okay.
You know, I can like the physical object. And the DVD drops on September 17th.
All right. Sounds awesome. Well, Joe, thank you so much. And I want to extend an invitation to you. If you're ever in New York, we'd love to have you stop by the studio.
That would be fantastic.
All right, Joe. Well, thank you so much for your time, and best of luck with the film. It's wonderful.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, Joe. Be well. All right, guys. So we're going to take a short commercial break, but we'll be back with our film review segment right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude. Patent pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Hey, Rich. How are you?
I'm good.
I thought we were going to be in the same train today. Okay. You made it. And we're back, guys. Our film review segment at Under the Radar. And we've got two critics here. Rachel Kolb, hello. And Erica A. Hello.
Hey, glad to be back.
Yeah. Welcome back, guys. So we've got two films to talk about today. I know you didn't get to see the first one.
Yep, I didn't, unfortunately.
It's okay, it's okay. No guilt, no guilt.
But you'll jump in and we'll just pretend you're not here.
So this is an interesting, it's based on true events. It's called Official Secrets. And it deals with the events leading up to the Iraq War and a British intelligence officer leaks a memo to the press, I think trying to avoid the war.
I was going to say more trying to expose the truth of as the media.
She's a whistleblower.
Exactly. Yeah.
And played by Keira Knightley, who's decent. And I never really liked her particularly. I didn't think she was great in the Pirates films. But she gave a very strong dramatic performance here. And Erica, what did you think of it?
I mean, I enjoyed the movie. It built up and it had a good aspect built on the fact that, like you said, it's based on actual events.
Yeah.
So someone who was alive then, and I do remember it.
Oh, you do? You do? Okay.
Oh, we were in high school.
We were, but I don't remember her name, Catherine
I don't remember
Gunn.
Her, but I remember the idea of building up to the Iraq War.
Right, of course.
And everyone trying to point the finger, and the British and the UN, and so it has the feel that you really know this is what happened, and it does feel realistic, and then it has the dialogue and the dramatization.
Yeah.
And so it is well done. The music is in the right places. The lighting is well done. Mm-hmm. It's enjoyable. There's no point where you feel like it's just, this is unbelievable. This is stupid. Why are they doing this?
Yeah.
There are a few points, though, I have to say that the plot drags a little.
Yeah, it's a little, it is a little boring here and there. But
and I thought that the romance that they tried to...
Her with her husband?
Yes.
It was okay.
Sometimes became a little too taking away from the movie itself.
Yeah. Who plays the husband in it? I looked at the cast list briefly before.
That would be a good question.
Yeah, his name is Adam Bakri.
Okay.
Well, he did a good job in the role.
Yeah, he's okay. Yeah.
Okay.
There's a subplot where he's about to get deported, and she kind of intervenes because.
Well, no, the lawyers intervene, but the lawyers they all were named people, and they did a great job.
Right. Ralph, Ray, is it Rafe or Ralph? Rafe Fiennes? Rafe Fiennes.
I believe there are two. I'm not sure if it's Ray or...
Rafe Fiennes is the main lawyer.
Okay.
And...
Because it's Joseph Fiennes and Rafe Fiennes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, this is definitely Rafe from Grand Budapest Hotel. Mm-hmm. Great film.
Okay, that's what you're going to pick, but all right.
Or Schindler's List?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Red Dragon was also very good. He's just good in everything.
At least most of the time.
Yeah. But Rachel, are you a fan of films that deal with actual events that are grounded in reality?
Well, I will say I did take a look at the director and
Gavin
writer
Hood.
Of this, who I know that he also did Rendition, was actually a film that I wrote a piece on back when I was in college. I was writing about movies that were trying to tackle the Iraq War.
Okay.
And trying to do that as it was like happening and as it was unfolding. And specifically this one dealt with extraordinary rendition of basically indefinitely keeping people prisoner and like not having to follow the usual rules as far as due process. I think it can be a little bit tricky. Personally, I think that you need to really focus in on like a much smaller story within something like the Iraq War or within something like this.
I was going to say, and that might be the one flaw of this movie, that it focuses on too broad of a scale at a certain point.
Too broad.
Yep, and that was the problem with Rendition as well, definitely.
Okay.
So that might be the one regret if you do go see it, that it works on too large of a scale and it sort of bounces between three different sets of characters all working simultaneously.
There were a lot of characters to focus on and care about in this. That was a little distracting.
Or not care about.
Yeah.
Dealt with the fine folks at the Observer in England.
Right, and, the newspaper cast, which I think was the best plot of it.
Right, Matt Smith.
Yes, of Doctor Who.
Doctor Who.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. Well, one of the many.
I was going to say Downton Abbey, but that's wrong.
Downton, not downtown.
Downton. And Matthew Good, also very good.
Yes, yep.
Rhys Ifans? Rice.
Oh, yes.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was Lizard in The Amazing Spider-Man.
Yes.
Among other
things,
The Replacements. Mm-hmm. And Conleth Hill. He's a lesser-known actor, but he's very, very good. Mm-hmm. So the cast is there. It's a strong, solid cast. And they tackle the film well. I respect Gavin Hood's direction. But I also love I think the best part of the movie is the screenplay.
Okay.
Eric, were you a fan?
I think the screenplay goes into the same problem that at points there are too many things to focus on.
Okay.
And so it overlaps into the movie itself.
Right.
But I think the movie did a good job of trying to create a story around a time period.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't mind seeing more work from many of the people involved.
Right.
So if you're interested in a movie... I'd say go see it. It's definitely on the radar. It's a nice, it has a little spy, it has a little drama, it has a little almost like documentary type thing, but not
quite. It's educational. I mean, I really didn't know much about Catherine Gunn at all until this film.
And I don't think I remembered that either.
Yeah. So it's very
interesting. I did regret, though, that Keira Knightley didn't look anything like her. They didn't even give her the right hair color.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I am a fan of Keira Knightley.
Yes,
I
mean, absolutely. Yeah.
Really?
I'm not saying that
I just don't like her. Okay. I mean, she's pretty, but she doesn't really have much range.
I really enjoyed her Atonement. I thought she was absolutely fantastic.
Okay.
And everyone's really fantastic in that movie.
McAvoy's in that, right?
I've actually been a fan of her all the way back to Bang It Like Beckham.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Bang It Like Beckham
was
fantastic.
Yes. She was decent in that. Yeah,
she was really great in that. And there was another one I was just thinking of. Pride and Prejudice, of course.
Actually, no.
You didn't like
that? That is my least favorite movie she's ever done.
Wow.
I enjoy the one from the 30s. I enjoy the one that they made in the late 90s with...
Wait, is this the new one, Colin Firth? Is that what you're
No, that's the one from the 90s.
That's the 90s.
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
That's the one I... Mm-hmm. Heart, that's the one that
Darcy and
that will always be the definitive Pride and Prejudice for me, the six hours.
And I understand that. I totally get that. That was the first Pride and Prejudice I saw as well. But I do love the Keira Knightley one for
I think it's just ridiculous. I think that the way they shoot it seems overly dramatic and too much rain.
I was going to say, that's definitely a trademark of that director, of Joe Wright, because he also did Atonement and does those very long, extended takes. Huh. He likes working with Keira Knightley quite a bit, obviously, because...
His muse, I guess.
Yeah, and I think Anna Karenina was also his as well. That was the one that was...
Yeah, Anna Karenina.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Was that also Knightley in that? Or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And The Duchess is a fun movie. Yeah. No, not a fan. Okay. I like The Duchess.
Honestly, I haven't really seen her in anything except the Pirates series, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But I'm going to check out these movies you're mentioning now.
Yeah, definitely. At least Bend It Like Beckham is very good stuff. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay, so Erica, see it, skip it?
See it if there's not a better choice. It's definitely worth it. It's not your first choice on the list. It's definitely on the radar.
Yeah.
Maybe something for a late night rental or when it comes to cable.
Yeah, I was intrigued. Like the story
definitely
was very
intriguing.
Yeah, definitely great cast.
Definitely educational.
Yeah, for sure.
I don't know. And I, like I said, I wish there was a little more focus on the press plot of the newspaper company.
I think they handled the press stuff pretty.
I know, but
adequately.
They were the characters I actually felt captivated with.
Yeah, like going more to their backstory, like their personal lives. That would have been.
Or maybe a competing paper and how they were saying how they were. One-sided and how they were trying to take it from the other side and the building up to finding the CIA agent. That plot I cared about.
Yeah, it was interesting.
I wonder if it's kind of like with The Big Short, where there were like all these different plot lines going
on. I would
and
compare
really...
it very much
oh,
to it.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And only a few that you're actually really, really invested in, at least in my, for myself.
But yes,
myself,
that's
personally.
A good way to compare this movie. So if you like The Big Short, maybe this is your type of movie.
And also, I would say that this has very strong influence of Aaron Sorkin. Because the writing is very sharp, very good screenplay, coupled with the actors reciting the dialogue. It just
and also good wardrobe. I liked.
It's like last thing I was thinking of, but okay, it fit the period.
Yeah,
of
and also 2003. I liked where they go to the courtroom and they all have the wigs.
Oh,
on,
that
and
yeah.
I was like,
well, that's a tradition, and they did that a lot. They did in A Fish Called Wanda.
Yes.
Yeah.
One of my favorites.
Yes.
All right, so I say see it as well. It's a fun, not fun movie, but...
It's definitely worth the radar.
It's on the radar. It's a quality film. And go see it, guys. So we're going to take a short commercial break, but we'll be back with our final film review today, Angel Has Fallen. Stay tuned.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude.
Yeah, because
patent-pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry.
Loss.
For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Stop loss, I feel like, is a much better example, honestly, like of something that takes on that bigger issue, but focuses more on these stories of how it is.
And Richard, you saw all the Fallen.
I saw all of the Fallen.
And we will. Oh, Okay. And we will see which one is your least favorite.
I haven't seen all of them. I just saw parts of the first and second. So, all right. And we're back, guys. Welcome to Under the Radar. And this is our second film of the film review segment. And we're going to be talking about the new action thriller, Angel Has Fallen, the third in the franchise, yes. Starring Gerard Butler. There he is, as a devoted Secret Service agent who protects, he's protected Aaron Eckhart as president, and now Morgan Freeman as president. And now basically he is being set up by an unknown source. We're not going to spoil that. And he's trying to clear his name. So, Rachel, what did you think of this one?
Well, we say no spoilers, but pretty much these movies are set up. So from the beginning, you yes. just look at the character and know this is the person that's going to betray him.
Yeah. So, I mean, they're entertaining. They're stupid,
yes.
but they're entertaining. So I respect them for that.
Yes.
And people will go see these movies no matter what. I think this will be a nice capper. Like, we have a good trilogy here. So I don't know if they're going to make more or
go
prequels.
For a fourth.
You think a younger Gerard Butler?
No, I think there should be just one more.
One more,
let
really?
Let it end at four.
Okay.
It is kind of baffling to me.
But give Morgan Freeman a chance to be president. That's what I said.
I yes. wanted so much more of him in this.
He spent most of the movie in a coma.
Yeah. But it made me love and care for him all the more. I was like,
he was earning
poor,
a paycheck being
president.
Yeah, it's kind of like Michael Caine in The Last Witch Hunter spends most
yes.
of the movie
oh, really?
Just laying out unconscious.
Well, when you're that big of a name, you really don't have to do anything. You could just... be in bed the whole movie. It's fine.
Yeah. Just take a little nap and get a paycheck.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I can't argue with it. The man has certainly earned the right to do that at this point in his career.
Sure.
But my feelings on this franchise, especially this last one, is really kind of baffling because it's kind of two minds. The franchise overall, as a whole, is very jingoistic, very, like, yay, raw America. But then...
But also very formulaed at the same time.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But the interesting thing about this third one is who they choose as the villain of it. Mm-hmm. That the villain is private contractors and a character that wants to make America strong again.
Yeah,
that
strong
you have
or
those
something.
Contrasting things.
Yeah.
That it's aimed at this one audience, but then setting up these elements as the villains mm-hmm. of it. So, but then at the same time that they're like, oh, there's this whole conspiracy about is he working with the Russians? But, oh, that's completely ridiculous.
And there's a scene with Putin.
Russians
there's
are just
a video of him.
Yes.
With,
yes. That was a beautifully done edited piece.
Yeah.
I have to commend them on the fact that they use the technology in the right way, that it's not over the top like things that are too CGI'd.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like the first film's action sequences were very CGI heavy.
The second
yeah.
one's CGI was
yikes. Well, the second one was sort of funny in that way.
Yes. I have to say, out of all three, the second one is my favorite.
Mine too. Mm. The second one is my favorite. It feels the most believable. And it feels, at the same time, it feels the most action-packed without it being all about the action scenes.
Mm. Yeah.
The first one I thought was a little too much about the action.
I feel like the second one is the most aware of what it is.
Yes.
And it has the most one-liners. Definitely the one-liners were missing from this one. There were not
I know.
Enough.
There wasn't the same quirkiness. It wasn't like, it never took the time to take a moment every so often just to check itself and make a humorous comment. It was all formulated plot. Let's go through it. It's very predictable, unfortunately.
Well, the first one is
but
very
it's still
Die Hard-esque.
Yes, it's Die Hard.
I was
going to
say, but it's still better than the first one.
Okay, yeah.
I really liked the fact that this one did have some aspects to it, and I cared about the characters.
Right.
I actually missed, though, a lot of characters that weren't there anymore. Like
Angela Bassett?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
She's good. She's a great actress.
That absolutely.
I know. But that's a spoiler for the second one if you haven't seen it. But
yes. Yes. The fact that this franchise, no spoilers, that it introduces several actors that I very much enjoy throughout all three films and then kills them off in ways that I'm not okay with.
Well, I'll tell you, one actor who I've been following over the past couple of years, Tim Blake Nelson.
Tim Blake Nelson is
fantastic
great.
Fantastic in this, as always.
This is about the most un-Tim Blake Nelson role I think I've ever seen him
in. And this is right after Buster Scruggs.
Yes, Buster Scruggs, which is the most Tim Blake Nelson role, I think, aside from that and Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, I think, are the two most Tim Blake Nelson roles.
The Coens should have directed this, I think. It would have been very interesting. No.
I can only imagine the Coen brothers doing this sort of action movie.
Don't even think that. No, I am not ready to go there.
But it would have been an interesting choice, I think.
Yes.
And also Danny Houston, who I've liked for a while. Well, he was in X-Men Origins. Uh-huh. Yeah. It's a very interesting, very charismatic.
As you say that, I think, oh my God, as I sort of laugh and I'm like, yeah, when I looked at it and I thought, all I see is his X-Men role when I looked at him in the movie and I'm like, yep.
Well, he's always kind of like that stuffy, corporate.
Yeah, shoulder.
Like this kind of imposing, authoritative figure. And he does it very well here, too.
Mm-hmm. And also, does it very routine.
Yeah.
Yes.
And actually, also, my personal highlight of this movie was Nick Nolte's performance.
Yeah.
As Gerard Butler's
character's father. That was the one spark of, like, what was in the second one and the tone of the second one that I felt like carried over.
Mm, okay.
So.
Nice. So. One regret, though, I did have was also, why did they recast the wife?
Yes.
Yeah, that's so originally Radha Mitchell, and now we've got Piper Parabo from Coyote Ugly. What is she doing here?
Well, I was going to say from many other things, but sure, from Coyote Ugly, Covert Affair, Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Imagine Me Too.
Yes. Yep. Mm-hmm. I mean, I like her as an actress, but I kept looking, and I was like, she doesn't belong here. She's not the wife.
Wait, was she in the second one?
No.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Nope.
Interesting.
From the first and second one, it's, as you said, from she's probably the thing I recognize her most from is the Silent Hill movie.
Okay.
And she was also in Finding Neverland.
Yes, that's where I remember her most from.
Radha Mitchell, she's been in some things. She's kind of like a Nicole Kidman type. No. Charlize Theron, I want to say.
Okay.
Maybe closer to Charlize, yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. So I'm curious about something. These films, I know London Has Fallen. And this one, well, not this one particularly, but London Has Fallen, it came out, what, a few weeks after the shootings, if I'm not mistaken, in London?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of critics...
And it was very controversial.
A lot of people, criticized the film for their timing of the release, how it was just insensitive to the families and everyone involved. This one also kind of tackles real life. Like, they show Putin, they say Make America Strong Again. So what do you guys think of these parallels to reality?
Well, I think that in some ways it's a good thing. Like, compared to the other movie that we reviewed, it's very interesting.
Right. But that came out over a decade after the events.
I know, but that could have come out a week later and be closer to 9/11 and be more close to it.
True.
Yeah.
And this one... Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
And this one comes out in our time of the questionable, what's going to happen next. Right. Everything is so chaotic. The political atmosphere that we don't even know if this came out. And so it's probably for the best that it came out before anything worse did happen.
That's a good point.
Because though the one regret is that they don't use any of the background, it doesn't actually feel like it's taking place.
In like the present.
Well, I was going to say in the scenes that are supposed to be, you don't get the same backdrop of Washington.
Yeah.
It was a little more subtle than London Has Fallen in that respect.
But it does sort of paint the tone compared to some of the other franchises that are very similar to this, like Bourne, which can take place in any time period. This is clearly the here and now.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's true.
I did have to laugh, though, because considering how much they blew up the White House in the first movie and how slow it takes for them to get these things rebuilt, like we've seen with the Freedom Tower here in New York, New Jersey, I had to laugh about that because I'm like, no, they wouldn't already be back in the Oval Office. They'd probably be in like some trailers or something, like offshoot trailers.
Or some bomb shelter somewhere.
Well, that
exactly.
Well, the first film was, Olympus Has Fallen, was 2013. Are they following a timeline? Or is it more
It's
condensed?
Hard to tell. They don't say exactly how much time has passed.
Right.
Yeah.
But they give you the idea that it's taking place in real time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So like over 6 years.
Yeah, because I know that at the beginning of the second one, there's a line about running for re-election. The fact that Eckert as president is running for re-election. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, he's not in this. So.
No.
I don't know if that's a spoiler or not. But
it's
in the poster.
President's
Anyone
change.
Who can read.
Right.
A script can, or who can read, like IMDb can see that he's not on it.
Right.
Yep. And that doesn't mean anything's necessarily happened to his character. It's just,
yeah.
There's a new president
change.
Now.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Yep. Yeah, as far as my thoughts about, you know, the timing of this coming out, I mean, anyone that's watched BoJack Horseman and the episode Thoughts and Prayers?
I have not.
There's an episode of BoJack Horseman. It's all about the fact that they keep trying to release this movie that is ultra-violent, involves this person shooting a bunch of people in a mall.
Okay.
And the problem is that every time they keep pushing it or, like, changing it to make it more palatable to release it, another shooting happens. Mm. And so every time that they have these board meetings that they're like, well, we have to push this again, they always have to throw out the thoughts and prayers, thoughts and prayers, thoughts and prayers.
That's dark.
Yeah.
No, continue. I'm sorry.
And then the other thing I was going to say about it is that that the release of The Hunt just got canceled entirely.
Yes. Okay.
Like, that they're not even releasing it now because they thought it was going to be insensitive.
Wait, remind everyone The Hunt.
Yes, The Hunt. It's a movie coming out. It's kind of based on Most Dangerous Game. It's a bunch of poor people that have been kidnapped and are being hunted by wealthy people.
Oh, wow.
And it's played as, like, a very dark comedy.
Oh, wow. That's,
yeah.
Crazy. Sounds like that Ice-T film from the from 1993, Survive the Game or something. Anyway.
Yeah, I would say it's probably pretty similar, but it definitely has, like, an all-star cast as far as, like, from the comedy world.
But considering that they still release Purge movies.
Yeah.
Are they still doing those? I thought they were done with those.
Well, they've moved on to a TV series.
Mm-hmm. Oh, gosh.
Yep. It's on USA. I believe it's in its third season coming out.
Yeah, because the last one was the first Purge. Where they did, like, the
prequel.
Too. Oh, I see. Gotcha.
Yep. Which I actually enjoy the Purge franchise for the most part. I haven't watched the TV show, but
I've looked at the show, but it's just a longer version of the movies, and so sometimes it gets a little dragged out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it's just an interesting thing how some things are accepted and other things aren't. But that goes all the way back, even to the 90s, like the Buffy episode with the gun.
Yeah. Mm.
That they didn't want to show it because they were so upset because there were school shootings.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So there's never a safe time to really move forward with something.
Something is always going on.
Yeah. There's so much chaos and turmoil in the world that we live in today.
But there are some things that you can't escape at all, like 9/11. I know they wanted to do True Lies 2, like in 2002, but they kind of scrapped that idea. Because it was about heavily influenced by, you know, the stories of terrorism and fighting terrorism. But it was just a very bad time for that.
Yes.
I hope they come out with it again in the future, but we'll see.
Yep.
So, okay, we've got a couple minutes left. I just want to say, see it or skip it, Angel Has Fallen.
I would say that this is one you could either see for, like, a cheap matinee or wait for it to come out on Blu-ray.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd say see it. I'd say it's on the radar. It's out there. It's worth it. It's not quite the best movie that's out right now.
No.
But it's summertime. So summertime is supposed to be fun.
Yes.
Summertime, it's supposed to be exciting. So this is a summer movie. Mm-hmm.
And it finishes out the summer fairly nicely in that respect. And, you know, if you're fans of the franchise, of the trilogy, it has a nice flow about it. And if you're a hardcore Gerard Butler fan, you're going to love this one.
Or a hardcore Nick Nolte fan. Yeah, definitely. Yes. For certain, definitely.
Because he was my favorite aspect of this film.
Yes, and Lance Reddick is underused in this
film.
Oh,
yeah.
Also.
From the John Wick films.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Why he doesn't have his own franchise at this point, I don't understand. Because I just think he's immensely
talented.
They could
just have a spin-off of him in the hotel of John Wick.
Like, yes.
Just called The Hotel or The Concierge, starring Lance Reddick. That would work beautifully.
Yes, would watch it.
Good. So I actually, you brought up something last night, the D23.
D23, yep.
The Disney conference.
Yes.
Where they're announcing all the new Marvel films, Disney films, Star Wars films.
Yes.
Did you want to talk about that a bit?
Yeah,
what
absolutely.
To expect?
I would say probably my biggest surprise of the announcements, I did not know for one that they were making a Flora and Ulysses movie, which is by one of my favorite authors, Kate DiCamillo. She also wrote The Tale of Despero, which was also turned into a movie.
Oh, yeah, Matthew Broderick, right?
Yes, and Because of Winn-Dixie, also made it into a movie. She's won all sorts of awards, including this one won the Newbery Medal, I believe.
Oh, nice. That's like the highest honor for a children's book?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, children and youth books, yes.
Nice.
Or one of two.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's about basically a young girl, and she gets she beats the squirrel, who becomes basically her best friend and has superpowers. And it's cool. Just an absolutely adorable book. I'm really happy to hear that they're making it into a movie. Nice. And then the other biggest surprise was for Disney Plus, which is Disney's upcoming streaming service.
Cool.
Yep. And it is
goodbye Netflix, goodbye Hulu.
Well, that's the interesting thing, is that right in the midst of all the D23 announcements, that Netflix announced the Breaking Bad movie.
Ah, yes, yes. Which I feel like
it was a little bit of a hit back at D23.
Yeah.
I mean,
I'm not complaining,
but
that's awesome.
Well, it's definitely a retaliation, I would say.
Yes.
Not a little.
But the other biggest surprise for me for Disney Plus for their new shows was The World According to Jeff Goldblum.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Which I cannot wait for. I'm so excited.
Is this a movie or a series?
It's a TV series that is going to be...
So
it's basically Jeff Goldblum going across the country and doing episodes on just things that interest him. It's just Jeff Goldblum goes and does this or tries this or explores this weird subculture. That's literally the show.
Like him making pottery or something.
Yeah. It's his version of every star who's done that so far.
Kind of like comedians in cars getting coffee, yes, in a way.
Yeah, or like Stephen Fry in America, very much similar to that. Or even An Idiot Abroad a little bit, too. Okay. So
cool. That sounds fun. When is DX isn't established out? It's out, not out yet, is it?
Disney Plus has not launched yet. Okay. I think it's launching in November, but they're going to be unveiling. I know at D23 they did unveil payment for people that were specifically at the expo, mm-hmm, that they could buy for the next 3 years and get a much reduced rate. But of course you had to be at the expo for it. But I'm sure, uh-huh, that they're going to be unveiling the payment stuff for everybody else very soon here.
That's cool.
And we also got a new trailer for The Mandalorian, which, uh-huh, is going to be very exciting for Star Wars fans.
Now, I saw a photo. Is that Billy Dee Williams in that, or is that a different Star Wars project?
That's a different Star Wars project. Okay. Yeah, they did show some footage as well from the last Star Wars.
Okay.
Yeah, and unveiled some pictures, including Rey in what looks like her dark side outfit and a double-sided lightsaber.
Ooh.
So.
Cool. Exciting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Erica, are you a Star Wars fan?
Some, not as strong as you, I don't believe. But no, I followed all the series since Disney took control. Mm-hmm. They've made three different series based on their XD channel, mm-hmm, and how they've built up on them. I followed the movies. I've looked at some of it. Actually, have met people who have done it, and I've seen the people who do the exhibitions with the lightsabers. Yeah. But it's like, I'm not that into it, and I worry sometimes about the control that Disney has. Mm. And though they've, in the most part, went the right way, even Solo,
right,
who too many people were criticizing. Mm-hmm. Okay, you're one of...
No. I actually enjoyed Solo quite a bit.
Oh, because you were like, and I was like, oh, okay.
I just understand that in general, it was a little bit more of a lukewarm reaction to it initially. I feel like it's some people have come around on it, though.
Yeah.
Okay. No, yeah. As your interpretation, I was like, I was like, is this like the, Solo?
No, and you know what? Mm-hmm. That segues into something else Disney related. Marvel and Spider-Man.
Sony has, I think, though, that the petitions have burned the bridge.
What happened, though?
Because they were going to do is they were working on Venom. And I always thought that they were going to just, if everything was quiet, they would slowly work out a new contract. Mm. And now Disney has nothing to grab onto because they're desperate. Mm. They have,
they
have nothing to argue with.
Yeah. Yeah, like with the fact that they literally went from the negotiations breaking down to D23, it almost felt like Disney was putting out there, we don't necessarily need you, Sony. We've got all these other things going on. And then the fact that they had Tom Holland scheduled to come out on stage and that he even said, guys, you know, I know that things are really up in the air and we don't know what's going to happen, but we're going to try to tell the best story. And I love you 3000, which he throws in, of course, for the fans. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I feel like Disney has the upper hand right now in all of this.
And I think Sony does because they own it, and Disney would want him back.
Yeah. Mm.
I thought that it would be like, okay, they'll make a Venom 2, yeah. and Tom will make a cameo with Spider-Man. And then Spider-Man would go back to the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
It's so sad. The Tom Holland Spider-Man films are fantastic. They broke records, but they did extremely well at the box office.
They've been my favorite from the Marvel franchise in a while.
Yeah.
I haven't been as much a fan.
Like, keep going. Keep
going. I thought Far From Home was fantastic.
Yeah, it was fun.
It was really good.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess we'll have to see what happens over the next few weeks. But after that statement that Sony put out, And again, like, I just want them to work it out. I just, like, I feel like it's, you know, a case of mom and dad are fighting.
Couples therapy.
Yes, guys, work it out.
We're going to work it out, and without the petitions and without the fandom going
and
nuts.
I don't want to see a fourth Spider-Man actor. Come on. With enough already.
Yeah.
Tom
and
Holland
is the best.
Starting
from the beginning, I don't need that.
No. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We don't need another origin story. We don't, you know, any of that.
Yeah, and with everything that was set up at the end of Far From Home, it feels like such a loss.
Mm-hmm.
With bringing back J.K. Simmons. And, you know,
that was awesome. Slight spoiler. That's okay.
Yeah. At this point, if you haven't seen and you're that invested, I don't know what to
tell you. Shame on you.
Right.
Yes, exactly. The other thing, actually, that I want to bring up really, really quickly from D23 was their showcasing of their new animated films and the new Pixar films, because they are unveiling some new original stuff.
Cool.
Not sequel stuff.
Oh, original
and
stuff.
Not rebooted live-action versions to make money.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which, granted, they did unveil some of those, like the trailer for the live-action Lady and the Tramp.
But oh, God, really?
Yes. Yeah, that's a thing that's coming.
Stop, Disney, stop. It's enough already. All right. So that's cool. Another thing I wanted to mention, the Ghostbusters Halloween Horror Nights attraction.
Yes.
You also wanted to, I want to talk to you about that.
Yes.
Briefly, very.
So this year, Orlando Universal is really focusing on kind of classic movies with their houses. A lot of like classic horror movies. They're doing a Universal Monsters house that's going to be like Frankenstein and Dracula and like the classic monsters.
Nice.
They're doing one that's based around Killer Clowns from Outer Space. They're doing Ghostbusters, which I know a lot of people are very excited about.
Yes, awesome.
And they're going to be bringing back Stranger Things also.
Ooh, an attraction.
Yes.
Cool.
Yes.
That's cool.
And the one that I'm possibly most excited about, aside from the Ghostbusters one, is they're doing an Us-themed maze.
Oh my God, that's going to be terrifying.
Yes, right?
I would go just for that.
Yeah.
Get a plane ticket. Oh my God. Really? An Us attraction?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
That's cool.
An Us maze. And having gone through those haunted
with the mirrors
houses,
and all that?
Like, that's what I have to imagine that it's going to
be. Yeah,
is it's going to be like the house that she was going through.
Oh my God. And they just flash images of yourself or something.
Ugh.
Crazy.
I can only imagine. But they do a great job down there. I can't recommend it enough.
Gotcha.
So.
All right. So we're running out of time. 40 seconds. Erica, anything you want to plug?
Oh, no. I'll just pass.
Okay. You good? You sure? All right. Rachel.
I don't have much to plug, but you can find me on Twitter at Rachel E. Kolb. You can find my theater reviews at ludusnyc.com, also on Twitter at ludusnyc. And keep an eye out. I've got hopefully some interviews coming out from Company XIV's new show, Queen of Hearts, which is fantastic. So cool.
Cool.
Oh, wait, look me up on Facebook, Erica, E-R-I-C-K-A, last name A-S-S-E-R-S-O-N, or email me, editing, production, so on. Okay.
Yes, and some... Magnitude, a wonderful sponsor, Magnitude Jewelry, some plugs from them. September 6th to the 8th is the Mind, Body, Spirit Expo in Denver, Colorado. September 20th to the 22nd, the Yoga Festival in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. October 18th to the 20th, the New Life Expo at the New Yorker Hotel in New York City. And we've got in November, the Naval Expo in Tarrytown, New York. And lastly, the Heart Freedom Expo in Chicago, Illinois. We'll have more information regarding those in the future. But next week, there will be no Under the Radar, unfortunately. But I'll update you guys on social media and all that wonderful stuff. So I want to welcome, thank Rachel Kolb and Erica A. And I want to thank everyone watching at home and on your tablets, your devices, everything. We'll be back with more Under the Radar in 2 weeks. So we'll see you next time. Take care, guys.
Under the Radar is all new next week with more movie reviews and interviews on Strong Island Radio and Television. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.